Thank you very much, Dr. Thakur. And at the outset, I would like to profusely thank Dr. V.P. Rao. Normally, this kind of conferences have very little place for basic scientists. But then I was a little bit taken aback when I got the letter from Dr. V.P. Rao and thought probably it is good in a way that basic scientists also talk about the basic aspect of all the discussions that are going on. Most of the discussions yesterday and of course today have focused on how to deal with aging people, the aged ones. And when it comes to people like me, we ask the question at a very fundamental level, why age at all? What happens when we look the way that we look at a given age? What are the basic mechanisms behind the whole process? If we know more and more about that, then we can decide what to do. When we inevitably go through the process, how to manage it, how to mold it. So I think, can I have the first slide? Where is the point? Okay, thank you.
All right.
Well, this is the way that happens to every one of us. We are all concerned very much. And what I decided to do in 15 minutes, just go through very fast. And if any one of you have any serious question to ask, you can always ask me. This I wanted to show you, for many of you will be interested to know, death was not there in the primitive organisms. They don't die. Look at this slide. They divide by binary fission. A cell becomes, lot of food is taken in, it bulges and divides itself. The first thing that happens to is for the DNA. The DNA gets replicated and then it gets into two cells. The original DNA is squarely divided into the two daughter cells. Where is the death here? There is no death in primitive organisms. Even today in amoeba, it doesn't die. It keeps on living like this. Then over the period, evolution has taken place and then death has come in. For whatever reason it is, we cannot go into those details. Not only that, our lifespans are fixed by the nature. This slide shows very quickly, we live up to 100 years and the other animals, you can see the different figures. Yeah. 100, elephant 7, and the laboratory rat 3 years. Both are mammals. We are mammals, rat is mammal. It lives only 3 years and we live 100 years. Why? Then lots of research has gone in during the last 50 years, first of all. One of the most interesting facts about any organism living through its life is the Hayflick limit. This was done almost about 30 years ago. The person was growing some cells and in the petri dish, with all the nutrients provided in the petri dish, the cells divide. When they divide and there is no more space in the petri dish, they stop dividing. You take one cell from that and put it into the next petri dish, it grows again. It goes on like this as long as you are capable of doing it and not tired, but not after a number of passages. It is called a passage. For example, our fibroblasts, our cells, take from any tissue or the skin. They can go through these passages, if you take the trouble of transferring them from one petri dish to the other, about 50 times. 51st time, no matter what you do, it doesn't grow anymore. It doesn't divide anymore. So somebody has set a limit that you go thus far and no more. And this is species specific. Please note that. Okay, and then research went on and people found lots of genes which are responsible for the health and also the death in a way. Some of the genes I listed, we will not discuss all those things, just to impress upon you, there are certain genes, if you modify them, mutate them freakishly, the organisms, the experimental animals, either they live longer or some of them live shorter. So the question is, or the hope is here, that there is a chance for us to manipulate the genes that we have so that the longevity can be extended or shortened, if you like, both ways. People have also have looked at it, how many genes are responsible for over the period of evolution, whether they are responsible for the longevity, the lifespan that I showed you in the previous slide. Very interestingly, humans have very small number of genes that can be manipulated for their longevity, which means that we have already reached a level of saturation, that all that is to be done, that could be done, has been done by the nature already, except that there is some scope to manipulate certain genetic potential into the lifespan. But it looks we are almost at the end of such natural modification, at least for the time being now. I do not want to take away the hope. Now, specifically, my area of research. This slide was published in a journal called Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, USA, in 1964, at about the time that I got my PhD from this place, Indian Institute of Science. For the first time, this slide showed very categorically that the DNA repair capacity of an organism, if anything happens to DNA in its structure, our cells also have the capacity to repair it immediately. The mechanic is there in the cell itself. Such capacity has a correlation to your lifespan in all the species. This magnificent slide shows the same thing. For example, humans. All of us should be very happy that the humans are top in the repair capacity. And the next is elephant, cow, hamster. I'm unable to press this for some. Okay, all right. Hamster, rat, mouse. Mouse is here, but all these are mammals. So there is a correlation between the ability of the organism to repair of the damage in DNA, if there is a damage, and its lifespan. So this must have been done in the nature to see how the longevity, the lifespans have increased over a period of the various species that I have shown. Now, these are the different ways of DNA can be damaged in our cells. I will not go into details. But this is the theory on which we are working now, most of the basic scientists. If DNA is damaged for whatever reason it is, because of what you eat or because of what you do and because of certain chemicals that enter your body, we also have the capacity in the cells to repair such damage. There are a number of pathways. the higher the organism in its evolution, the more number of pathways. So they repair, just like a mechanic. And all these types of damages are repaired. And during the replication, sometimes their mistakes are done. And such mistakes are also immediately repaired. And if for some reason such repair is not taken place efficiently and the way it should be, either we get cancer or neurodegenerative diseases and aging. All these are put together. Now, I am switching my gears a little bit. While I talk about the DNA damage, I am also linking that to a recent study that we have done at the instance of Government of India. You know, Ayurveda is one of the oldest medicinal systems from India and some of the neighboring countries. However, it is not enjoying the reputation that probably it deserves. Or maybe it is enjoying the reputation that it doesn't deserve. How do you prove that? It is even claimed that God has spoken directly to sage Bharadwaj. That is the first step Ayurveda was told to the humanity. Save all those stories. Scientifically, how do we prove that the Ayurveda medicinal system has indeed a basis, a scientific basis? So recently, about 8 years ago, Government of India decided at the instance of Dr. Chidambaram, the advisor to the Prime Minister, and Dr. Valiathan, Marthand Valiathan, who is in Manipal University now. And our group is one of them, groups selected to examine whether we can validate scientifically the Rasayana therapy. This is them. Now, if you follow me, actually there is no need for me to... This is the young animals, adult animals and old animals. In the end, this is a comet assay. I think some of you might have had comet assay. This is a very powerful technique where you could actually see the cells under microscope and the DNA damage. When the DNA is damaged in the cell, what happens? It looks like that, the second slide. It diffuses. That means the DNA damaged is gone into pieces. Those pieces move much faster when you apply electrophoresis. And this is the old stage. You can see the damage is much more. Young, adult, old. One need not even explain. You can see directly the result here. Those are tabulated, of course, graphically also. Next slide, please. Yeah. Now, this is the important one I would like to draw your attention. The Amalika fed So this is the control animal. This is the way the DNA behaved in the normal animals, control animals. And on the right side you see the DNA when Amalika Rasayana was fed. I don't have to explain to you. The DNA damage is much less here. You see the diffusion. Okay? And then we went on to study the actual repair capacity of these cells, the brain cells in the rats fed Amalika Rasayana. This is the pathway through which all our DNA is repaired in your brain cells. And this is the only pathway that exists in your brain cells, neurons. If anything happens to this pathway, your brain cells will not function properly. All kinds of things will happen, pathological situations would result. And let us not go through the details. There are four steps in this. One is, today we can measure the single strand breaks, how many breaks are there in a DNA molecule, how many double strand breaks are there, double strand breaks means both these strands are cut, and single strand, each one of them is cut due to a variety of reasons. Now, this slide I would like to take a minute or two to explain to you very carefully. When the amylic rasayana was fed to rats for 3 months, I hope you can see this 3M here, that is the three months feeding. This CN means control, and the AFN means amylic fed neurons. These are the neuronal cells in the brains of these animals. The single strand breaks were measured in a very precise way by two different methods. One is the one already shown to you, the COMET assay, and the other one biochemical assay. We can precisely measure how many breaks are there in the DNA. So, this is the number, arbitrary number, depending upon the length of the COMET. Control, this much of breaks are there, and amylica fed, you can see it, and it is significant at a very, very, very high level. For 9 months feeding, same kind of pattern, and for 15 months feeding of the rasayanam, this is control.
So, you may summarize, not time is up for this.
Then I stop. So, any since the time is over, I would say summary, if you eat for amylic rasayana fed animals, the damage is much less, and also their DNA repair capacity is much better. This was proven beyond doubt by two different methods, and all this data is already published. So, there are two things I wanted to show you today. One is the DNA damage and repair plays a major role in the process of aging, and there are also ways and means to control such damage to the possible extent, not beyond any particular level that is unimaginable, but to a reasonable level. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Would you like to take up at least one question? I am sorry to intervene, but because of the time constraint,
I don't have to.
So, maybe we can have one question, short question. Yes, at the back.
And I study biotechnology. Thank you for the wonderful lecture. I would like to ask, what is the minimum age that such therapy should be started? For example, you mentioned the amylic rasa therapy. What is the minimum age that such therapy should be started to prevent DNA damage?
You see, three months in rat is approximately, you can say, is about 20 years or something like that in human beings. So, I would say you can start at any time. See, amylic rasayana is a supplementary thing. For example, my mother used to give me chyawanprasha every day when I was a kid. Not knowing what it is, but tasting all right, I used to eat a little bit of it. So, it is more or less taken as a supplementary food material. And same is the case with amylic rasayana. Amla is just essentially, it is gooseberry, having lot of vitamin C and other things. But it is the combined composition of this rasayana that is important. You take vitamin C and feed to the animal, the same effect may not be seen, the pure vitamin C. So, this is approximately equals to about 20 years or something like that. But I would say you can start anytime. This is to keep the cell more active and agile.
Last question.
Is this the only Ayurvedic product which is validated? Are you validating other products as well? And second thing is that by some newspaper reading, I got to understand that one of our former presidents who died was finally diagnosed to have some heavy metal poisoning because of a lot of Ayurvedic intake. Is it true?
Lot of what?
Lot of Ayurvedic
Ayurvedic
intake, yes, finally, yes. Heavy metal poisoning.
Yeah.
Is it true? And other products, are they validated?
You see, the last question I will ask first, being a biochemist. If you start using antioxidants in a bulk quantity, your metabolism will be upset. Because we live by oxidation, as you know. If there is no oxidation in the cells, we die. But the oxidation must occur in order to produce the energy. The only thing is, sometimes there is a tendency, because of the oxidative phosphorylation based life animals, if we don't take sufficient care, it can go bizarre and create problems. That is why most of the time antioxidants at a reasonable level are good to take. And also, that is true, one could even die, if you stop your oxidation, you will die. This could happen if you take a lot of antioxidants. And the first question, the other parameters you said, I studied only these two parameters. This was very fundamental, like DNA damage and repair. But there are other people. There is another one, Dr. Lapotia from Benares Hindu University. He used Drosophila as a model system and worked on something else, certain other factors.
Thank you, sir. Maybe we have to stop the discussion and continue that during tea break.
Sir, may I draw the attention of the house? I congratulate Professor Subba Rao on behalf of Department of Ayush, sir. You have done a great job working on Amal Ki Rasayan. Sir, in my lecture, I would like to answer your queries and highlight what is actually Rasayana concept, being an Ayurvedic expert. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Subba Rao. Maybe you can wait for a moment.
Thank you, Dr. Subba Rao. May I request Dr. Rao to honor Dr. Subba Rao for that wonderful presentation this morning. Dr. Rao, let's give a huge round of applause to Dr. Kakalla Subba Rao. Thank you so much, sir.